Now, we just played the E3 demo you guys have out for us today, and I don't know how you managed to do it, but Saints Row 4 is exponentially more insane than Saints Row 3 ever was, and that is amazing. So where did the idea come from to have aliens invade and then all of a sudden you get superpowers?
Well, the superpowers actually sort of came first. Like, we after Saints Row the Third, we kind of felt like, all right, where do we go from here? How do we top this? And so we started working on the idea of superpowers. Like, the first one to come up was super sprint, jumping, and then telekinesis. Like, that, I just always love the idea of, like, oh, I want to pick up that car and throw it across the city, or I want to pick up that person and throw them into another person. Like, it just sort of, we prototyped it very quickly, and it showed a lot of promise. So we moved forward with it, and, you know, I think the superpowers drove the idea that we had to have aliens, because if you can pick up people with your mind or freeze them, you know, you need to have enemies that can fight you. A gang with AK-47s is not going to present much difficulty to you as a player. So we needed aliens to bring in these great new tools for you with, you know, hover tanks and UFOs and new weapons like the black hole gun and all these great laser weapons. And so they present a real threat to you as a player, even with your superpowers. And they, on top of that, have their own superpowered unit or units. Enemies, one that falls out of the sky and is this big monster-looking guy, and he has his own superpowers, which you need to face off against him. So the aliens were really meant to counter the player's abilities.
Now, I love the Saints Row driving mechanics. Like, it's really simple. I love that you just hit a button and drift. It makes it easy. You guys have kind of eliminated the need to drive ever now with the super sprint. Now, was that, like, I mean, that was obviously a conscious choice, but was there ever any, like, back and forth there?
There was definitely times where we were kind of like, okay, what could we do with the cars to make them superpowered? You know, for a period of time, we actually had somebody prototype making the cars super jump as well, so you could charge up, drive your car along the street and then charge it up and jump it over a building, but it caused so many issues, and it looked pretty wonky, like having your car jump with you. So we tried a bunch of different things with vehicles, but ultimately what we felt was we're going to make this a superpowered game. Let's focus on the superpowers. Vehicles are absolutely still in the game. You can still customize them just as much as you want. You can have them teleported directly to you, so if you want to drive any car that you've customized in the past or saved, you can just spawn it immediately and drive in it. So there's that freedom is still definitely there for vehicles, and if people want to still drive them, which you will early in the game because your superpowers are not all that powerful, but once you can leap, you know, over 10-story buildings and run at 90 miles an hour, yes, you're probably not going to be driving cars as much in 4 as you would have in Saints Row the Third.
Whose idea was the dubstep gun, and why does it kind of break the game?
Oh, break the game. No, we like overpowered weapons. I mean, the black hole gun is another great example of it's fun to play with. But the dubstep gun came out of brainstorming. We had I came with a problem to the designers, and I said, we need a marquee weapon. We need a weapon that's really going to make people excited, because we had one with Saints Row the Third. We had one that everybody talked about. And so with this game, we needed to do something new and different. We didn't just want to make, you know, oh, it's a dildo bat that's 3 feet longer. So we didn't want to just, you know, sort of make it better. We wanted to do something brand new.
And black holes weren't enough, apparently.
No, not at all. We had some of these weapons, like the shrink ray and the black hole gun. We had those at the time. But my thinking was, we need some weapon that people are really going to glom onto, and, like, what are they going to love? And one of our designers just said, dubstep gun. And just right there, right away, we were all like, yes, that is going to be an awesome weapon. We don't know what it's going to do, how it's going to work, but it's going to be great. And we rolled with it, and, you know, all the team came up with a fantastic weapon in the end that everybody loves.
Whoever pushed for the fact that you have to wait for it to charge up, you have to wait for the drop for the gun to work, that was brilliant. Like, I just want to give my props to you. So, with all this insanity, did you have any troubles, like, maintaining the open world, like, making it big enough but not too big with all of these crazy powers you have now?
We never really had too much trouble. Our goal was, to build the city upwards rather than outwards. So we wanted you to be using the super leap a lot. We wanted you jumping from rooftop to rooftop, and we pull you that way as well with these things called data clusters, which are your currency for superpowers. So if you want to jump higher, you need to collect a bunch of data clusters. And it's this fantastic addictive gameplay of, you know, oh, a bright thing, I'm going to get that. Oh, I got it. Oh, another bright thing, I'm going to go get that. So it creates this really great gameplay loop of like reward and just spending a little bit of time, and you'll lose yourself completely in collecting stuff. So the city is a great area, a great toy box for the superpowers. But then in addition to that, we've got all the missions, which you go and recover all your teammates in these nightmare scenarios of theirs. So seeing what each of our characters would like be terrified of is a great thing. And seeing what the player is terrified of early in the game, I think players are really going to enjoy that sequence.
Now, this is a bit of a two-parter. How did you guys, because you went from, you know, Enter the Dominatrix, involving that into Saints Row 4, how did that evolve into the now story of Saints Row 4? Because having played the opening, I must say, I never thought you could top the plane sequence from Saints Row 3, but you have.
Well, I mean, Saints Row the Third came very quickly, or Saints Row Enter the Dominatrix came very quickly after the Third. When we were probably about 9 months into development of that. At the same time that we were developing Enter the Dominatrix, a team was developing Saints Row 4 as well. So Saints Row 4 actually started before Saints Row 3 had ended. There was a small core team developing the ideas. Once we got to the end of Enter the Dominatrix, we decided, you know, we like all these features, but we need to spend more time on them to really polish them. So what we did was pull them into Saints Row 4 and expand that game. So Saints Row 4, you know, the story that was in Enter the Dominatrix, not much of it was taken into Saints Row 4. Some of the concepts were, but there was a guy I hadn't talked to in a while on our team that was on Saints Row Enter the Dominatrix, but he wasn't on Saints Row 4. And when he came back and looked at what we had with Saints Row 4, he said it was basically unrecognizable to him as the game that we had worked on as Enter the Dominatrix. So I think we basically threw out all the cutscenes. The story got completely rewritten. So it's those two games are not at all the same, and Saints Row 4 is definitely a full-featured game.
Now, how big of a get was Keith David, and what was it like working with him?
Well, sadly, I didn't get to work with him. The writers and the audio guys got to go and meet him. But he was actually, you know, he was a voice actor in Saints Row 1 and 2 as Julius, one of our main characters. And so this time we felt it was sort of a nod to the same sort of thing we did with Burt Reynolds in Saints Row the Third, where it was Burt Reynolds as Burt Reynolds. Now we've got Keith David as Keith David. But Keith David also played Julius, so it's this great sort of like breaking the fourth wall, mocking ourselves, like, you know, just games are games and they're to be fun. And so Keith David we hadn't thought about him for a while, but then when we did say, oh, we got Keith David, it just sort of clicked for everybody. It was like, that makes a whole lot of sense, because we're sort of poking fun at what we did in Saints Row 1 and 2, and he's a really great actor, and he was in, you know, some of our inspirations for this game, he was in them as well. So I think he's really great in the game.
Now, you guys received a little bit of flack for the DLC for Saints Row the Third. Not everyone loved it. How have you guys taken that criticism and moved forward to your DLC plans for Saints Row 4?
Well, I think DLC is a really tough thing. It's you need to start thinking about it before you've shipped, but before you've shipped, you don't know how everything is going to work, how everything should be set up. So it's always very, very tricky. Especially for us, we tend to have plans early on, like, oh, okay, this is going to be what our DLC is, and then we get to the point where we're going to maybe start working on it, and then things completely change, and we need to throw out everything that we thought we were going to do. This time, we planned pretty early on that what we wanted to do was take, at least for our first pack, was take what we had built with Enter the Dominatrix, sort of take some of the pieces that we didn't pull into Saints Row 4 and pull those into a DLC pack. So we're going to release sort of an idea of what Enter the Dominatrix was as our first DLC pack. Beyond that, we don't have anything super specific, but, you know, we try and do better each time. We hope people will enjoy it. Ultimately, we probably won't make everyone happy, but we do our best to try to do that.
Well, it's good to hear that the Dominatrix isn't completely like dead either.
Yeah.
So when can we expect the game and where?
So Saints Row 4 is coming out August 20th on Xbox 360, PlayStation 3, and PC.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for talking with us. Yeah.